History hasn't been much kinder to Mary Todd Lincoln than the gun fired by her husband's assassin, John Wilkes Booth. The perception of her as mentally unstable or even insane has lasted for more than a century. But how much of Mary Todd Lincoln's reputation actually came from her refusal to conform to the gender expectations of her time?
Mary Todd was born in Lexington, Kentucky, in December of 1818.
Mary Todd was an incredibly well-educated woman, particularly for her era. Her father was liberally minded in regard to female education. The record suggests that all of his daughters received a really impressive formal education. Mary Todd was growing up in Lexington, Kentucky, which was an urban center in the Athens of the West, where there was actually the opportunity to receive an education if your family was supportive and they could afford to do so. Compare that to Abraham Lincoln, and it's a big contrast because he was growing up on the frontier and there wasn't the opportunity for formal education, even if your family could afford it.
Mary Todd is remembered as someone who is vivacious. I think her sister called her high-strung in one memory, that she was a wonderful conversationalist, that she could be quite quick and witty and sometimes a little harsh with her tongue, that she could sketch portraits in acid. Mary leaves the Todd house around 1839. She goes to see her sister Elizabeth in Springfield, and of course, that's where she meets Abraham Lincoln. I can't help but wonder what Mary thought leaving Lexington in 1839. It must have been a pretty big adventure.
Abraham Lincoln was already an attorney, and he already was involved in Illinois politics. So he was running in the same social circles that she was, and that is how they came to meet. They had a multi-year courtship. They shared a mutual love of politics, poetry, literature. Abraham and Mary Lincoln were married in Springfield, Illinois, at Elizabeth's home in November of 1842.
When Mary makes it to Springfield, she's considered to be quite the catch. She can make attention for herself at Springfield's parties. She's remembered by one young man as someone who can make a bishop forget his prayers. So she has a number of courtiers. Very famously, there was an interest by Stephen Douglas, who would become Lincoln's political rival later in his life.
She knew both Abraham Lincoln, her future husband, and Stephen Douglas, another very prominent man, and the two would have the Lincoln-Douglas debates, and that she had been involved with both of them.
The old story goes that they first met at a dance, and that Lincoln approached her and said, "Miss Todd, I would like to dance with you in the worst way." And Mary is supposed to have said, that's exactly what he did. Apparently, it was a rough start. Mary Lincoln wanted to be first lady. Mary Lincoln wanted her husband to be president. She loved it. She was a political creature. She was a political animal. Famously, in the election of 1860, when the telegraph results come through and Lincoln finds he has won the presidency, he runs through the streets going home and he's yelling, "Mary, Mary, we are elected."
The things she did to support his political career were within the domestic realm. Her role as a wife and a homemaker, everything from hosting political parties, gatherings.
When the Civil War begins in 1861, there are 14 Todd siblings. Mary's one of 14. Out of those 14 Todd siblings, 8 of them will side with the Confederacy, openly so. Mary will have 4 brothers who fight during the war. All 4 of them fight for the Confederacy. In fact, 2 of those brothers will be killed fighting for the enemy.
It led to accusations that perhaps Mrs. Lincoln was not entirely loyal to the Union. And those accusations were unfounded, but you can see how that situation would certainly be great fodder for those who were not Abraham Lincoln's political allies, but for his political rivals.
One of the first things that Mary does when she moves into the White House is she redecorates the White House. The White House was in poor shape. But she doesn't redecorate the whole White House. She's redecorating the public rooms. So when you have soldiers needing blankets out on the field, and you're buying French wallpaper, that's easy to criticize.
Mary Lincoln was with Abraham Lincoln in the box at Ford Theater. She was actually holding his hand whenever he was shot in the back of the head. Mary Lincoln, however, was not in the bedroom with Abraham Lincoln whenever he passed. She had been removed from the room. Some people say that she was removed for her own benefit because she was so distraught. And then there's others that argue that she was removed because her distress was irritating other folks.
Mary's life is one absolutely wrecked by tragedy. One of her earliest memories must have been the death of her mother when she's just a six-year-old girl. And after her marriage to Lincoln, in 1849, she'll lose her father very quickly within a few days to a cholera epidemic. Then she'll lose her beloved maternal grandmother. Then she'll lose her first child, Eddie. And then she'll lose her son, Willie. And then she goes on to lose her son, Tad. It's a life of woe.
Her oldest son, Robert, was her only child to live to adulthood. They had a tumultuous relationship. Mary Lincoln just had a premonition that Robert was dying, and she rushed to him, and he saw her agitation as instability. In a one-day trial, he provided her defense attorney. She was declared legally insane, which is a legal definition. And she was institutionalized for about 3 months in a private sanitarium. It's only in recent years that it came to be known how involved she was in getting released from the sanitarium. Some letters were discovered showing that she was sort of being her own advocate, and that had previously been unknown.
She returns to live with her sister Elizabeth in Springfield, and that's where Mary will pass away 2 years later. It was the same house where she was married. Her funeral was held in the parlor, the same parlor her wedding was held 40 years earlier.